I am lightning, the rain transformed. I am lightning, the rain transformed. Snake, it's my turn to protect you.
Like, the name's Lee. Got it memorized?
What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Daily here from Frag Nation, and today we are joined by the one and only Mr. Q, Mr. Quentin Flynn. How are you doing this evening, sir?
I am doing very well. How are you, gentlemen?
I'm fantastic.
Excited to see you. Yep. As always, joined by Corrupt Ronin.
What's up, guys? Pleasure to be here today. Pleasure to have Quentin Flynn here with us today. I'd like to first thank Penguin Jutsu and Oxy and all the Hitbox staff for helping get the word out about this interview on Hitbox. Really appreciate that, guys. And thank you to all the viewers that stopped by as well.
And Oxy is not OxyContin, so don't go there, people.
But good clarification from Mr. Flynn. And Yong, joining us today as always.
What's up, everybody? It's Yong here, and welcome to this amazing interview. I'm really happy to have you here, Quentin. It's an honor. I love the work that you do, and it's just, we're really excited for this interview here.
Amazing.
Thanks, Yong. So, Yong, guys,
Yong, yeah.
Yeah.
You guys are awesome. I think we're gonna let Ronan start this one off. I believe Yong started off the last one. So, Ronan, what is your first question for Mr. Flynn, or Q, right, as he's known in the community?
That's right, baby.
All right. So, as many people know, for the reason why they're here to begin with, is the fact that you were the voice of Raiden, obviously. So, my question is, in the beginning. In the beginning, how did you envision Raiden as a character? Like, what kind of person did you see him as before they actually gave you an idea of what he'd be doing in the game?
I just had no idea, to be quite honest. I really didn't. They're like, hey, be this character Raiden. I'm like, who? And they, I looked at a picture, and we call it in the industry sides, and it's a picture of the character, and there's a description of the character. And then I read it, and I kind of got an idea in my head of, you know, based on what they're asking for, what he might sound, what his attitude was. And I went into audition, and this name is familiar to you gentlemen because I've watched your shows. Chris Zimmerman was the casting director.
Of course.
Yeah. So, the question, folks, if you're just joining us or were here before, is what did I think of the character Raiden when I was asked to audition? Yeah. And I said I had obviously no one had any information about this character prior to MGS2. Right. So I looked at the character on page as it was written, and I went in with my best thoughts and intentions, and Chris Zimmerman was the casting director, and she and I had worked on the New Adventures, or Real Adventures of Johnny Quest, which was a reboot in 1996, 30 years to the day after it had originally aired in 1966.
Right.
The first voice actor, Tim Matheson. And Tim had gone on to fame in Animal House and a number of other movies. Long story short, I was honored to do that. Chris was the director on that series. So when I came in to do Raiden, and I started doing it, she said, well, you know, he's a bit older than Johnny. You know, maybe a little bit more edge. And we went back and forth, and we played with it. And that's not dirty, folks. It's just what happened. And thank you. So I gave her my best audition, you know, as we actors do. We take direction, and we put it out there and be in the moment and let it go. And that's what I did, and I walked away until I got a call, and they said, hey, you're going to be this character Raiden for Metal Gear Solid 2. And I went, awesome. Put me in, coach. I'm ready to play.
That's awesome.
Yeah. That's a cool little story about, you know, we hear different ways that people, you know, get these roles and the way that they, you know, get their characters, and it seems to like we're starting to understand, you know, that you don't really know a whole lot going into
right.
it, and even no. sometimes throughout the whole thing. So, Yong, what is your question for Q?
Yeah, so my question to you is, I was going to ask what's the story behind how you got the role of Raiden, but you kind of already answered that. But what are some things, some notes that you get throughout, you know, whether it be your audition or as you're performing Raiden, that you always kind of have to keep in mind to play the character?
Well, really, by the time we got to Metal Gear Rising Revengeance, you know, we had done 2, we had done MGS4, and obviously, as you guys know, and many of you out there, watching know, there's a difference between, you know, regular Raiden and shall we say Jack the Ripper.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's Raiden who's in here, man. What's going on? Listen, I got it. I can help you on this. And then, you know, when things get ugly, it's, you know, I am Lightning, the rain transformed. I don't want to have to rip your head off and shit down your throat, but I will if I have to.
So, I remember that one.
You know, which is which, and it does take the guidance of Chris in directing me when we've done this series for me to, you know, get back into either space, because mm-hmm. oftentimes we do scenes out of order, yeah. You know, and so she'll be like, you know, clean Raiden, you know, or young Raiden or whatever. She's like, Quentin, more Jack. Oh, okay. Less Jack. You know, okay. So, you know, I'm like a computer. It's like, doink, doink.
Sure.
Adjust.
Sure.
Quentin Flynn, everybody.
Yeah. I just want to give a quick shout out to the global fans out there. Anybody from Mayfield High School, my alumni, my cousin in England, Lisa Kay, Jody Braun, my personal manager, Darcy Dellis, one of my writing partners, Kirk Maharg, and my goddaughter, Lily. Mom, Bart, I love you. Kent State University, go. William Morris Endeavor clients, yes. You're here with me in spirit.
And so many kudos.
Spirit. In this spirit.
Those are my shout-outs. Yeah. Anybody else, send your Q&A.
Oh, wow. Yeah, so I guess it's my turn. So I'm curious of how this all started. How do you get into the career that you're into now? Did somebody just say, hey, you have a voice that belongs in games or TV? Because I know you did you did a lot of anime and you know, animated films and stuff as well. So how did it start? Who you know, told you should do it, or is it something that you decided to do on your own?
Yeah, it's something I decided to do on my own. I just went, hey, I'm here.
Yeah.
I'm fucking brilliant. Hire me.
Exactly. That's the theme that I get from you when we talk to you. You know, hey,
that's that attitude. I like that.
I'm the man.
You guys have been waiting for me, you know. Let's be honest, okay? You got other guys who are fine, and, you know, but you want the best?
Oh, man. There you go.
But it's the truth, you know. Heck, yeah, I got to be honest. It's like there's nothing they can put in front of me that I can't do. That's the way it is. So, and I've been doing characters and impressions since I was a little boy. You know, at the age of 8, my buddy Billy Russ and I would do impressions of impressionists' impressions that we watched on TV. And we would sit down and write lists at the age of 8. And then we'd go do these impressions at school. We do them for our friends. We do impressions of everyone around us. It's just, again, it's, and I've heard other actors probably say this to you guys. It's like, I don't know, it's like a recording in our heads. You know, it's like a DVR, before DVRs, and we'd regurgitate it. And I kind of liken it to this. It's all art. And I was always, you know, into fine arts. But I remember after 8th grade, going into my freshman year of high school, a friend of mine said, let's audition for a play. And I was like, why? He's like, well, my brother Dan does it. They're great. I'm like, I'm not sure. He goes, there's girls. I said, I'm in. and the thing that I found was I got the bug. Like, I did my first performance and I loved it.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. all of a sudden, not only the way in which I used to draw artistically to interpret and or copy or develop something, as I'd done with my voices, as I just told you, then it all came together in live performance. I was doing the same thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I started doing that on the stage in high school. Then I had a rock and roll band. Then after that, I went to college, studied radio, television, film, theater, mm-hmm. Did a radio show, you know, like you guys are doing, except I had nobody to interview. played music and was really, like, jazzed about that. I was a video host back in the day when VJs were the thing. And then my cousin Franklin, who was in my rock band, said, I want to move to L.A. and become a rock star. And I said, well, I need a vacation. I'll help you move. And the short of the long is, once I got here and I started sniffing around, I saw that there was a voiceover class for animation. And by this time, I'd already taken a commercial voiceover workshop, and I thought,
I can do this.
I should check this out.
Yeah.
You know? And I did. And long story short, after just taking that on, and putting aside the other things that I was doing and making that my main focus with the help of a lot of other people, I eventually got an agent, then started auditioning, which is the actor's life.
Right.
And it started this career in commercials and animation. And then little did I know, it would bring us to here. Years later, I'd be doing something called anime, which wasn't even in the vernacular when I started.
Right.
Video game voice acting did not exist.
Nope.
So, yeah, you know, and the funny thing is, people will say to me, and they'll say it to everyone, like, you know, I've heard I have a great voice. I should do voice acting. That's great. And you know what? Voice isn't acting goods, which means acting and training, then you're just a voice. Right. So, no, to answer your question, that was a long answer. I probably already answered some questions you have in front of you. You're going, oh, shit, now what?
And look, we're starting off easy. We got some good ones for you lined up. Don't worry.
Yeah, but no one said to me, you have a great voice, you should do voiceover. Right. But I will tell you a fun story. When I first moved to Los Angeles, I needed to make money. And a buddy of mine said, hey, man, there's this a game show called Win, Lose, or Draw. It was hosted by a guy named Burt Convy, created by him and Burt Reynolds. It was a Burt and Burt production. He's like, let's audition for this, because if you get it and you get on, get a chance of making money. So I did. And they called me up, and they go, yeah, we love you. So Burt Reynolds is going to be in this week, and he likes really, you know, good energy, and he likes bright people, and you're, you know, would you want to do it with Burt? Would I want to do it with Burt Reynolds? Yeah. Of course. Do I want him on my team? He wants me on his team. I'm in. In like Flint, baby. So we did the show, and as I'm being introduced, they have to ask you what you do. Right. Well, I couldn't say I was an actor because I never would have been able to do the game show. So I had been a sound production assistant and engineer for live productions and rock and roll with my buddy Kirk Mahar's sound company. So Burt Convy asked me, like, hey, Quentin, so tell us, what do you do? I said, well, I'm a live sound engineer for rock and roll bands in Cleveland. He goes, wow, you've got a really great voice. And in my head, I thought, oh, fuck. Is he knowing that I might be a voice? No, he didn't. But it was a sign of things to come. But it just blew me away. I was like, oh, my God, I'm kind of lying in the moment. Like, no, I don't do anything with my voice, Bert. Well, sometimes I sing in the shower. Oh, God, don't find it out. Anyway, we went on to tie. It was win, lose, or draw. It was a draw. But we both made money and walked away happy.
It's cool.
Nice.
Awesome. What an awesome story. Young, your next question for Mr. Flynn.
Sure. My next question to you is, are you a gamer? How many of the Metal Gear games have you played or completed? And how familiar do you think you are with the lore of Metal Gear?
I'm not a gamer. Unlike, I watched your Phil Lamar interview, and he really is. He seems to really know his stuff very well. And he also, it's amazing to me. So I learned a lot just about Phil the other day, even though we've done lots of work together. I didn't know he was a gamer. Amazing. I'm not, only because I lack the skills. So if anyone said, you should be a gamer, I'd go, why, do I look like one? Because I don't have any chops. I didn't play that much growing up. I didn't have a home console. None of my friends did. I only played in the arcade a bit. And when my ex-girlfriend's brother had Metal Gear Solid 2, I did try to play it unsuccessfully. Okay. And I kept playing. Start again. It was kind of like...
The controls are very hard to master.
Yeah.
And they're like... which the subtext of that was, you are ineffectual. You might be a loser. So I just said, bro, it's all yours. You know, you're the pro gamer. I'm the pro actor. You enjoy. I'll watch what you do. I'll do what I do. And it's going to be a beautiful marriage.
So have you watched people play the game and your scenes and stuff like that?
I've watched the playthroughs.
Okay.
But I've not, and I did watch him play the game.
Okay.
But I've not gone online to watch people play the game. And I know you can today, like with Periscope.
Yeah. Right.
Right?
Right.
It's like, yeah, you can watch someone playing a game. Well, maybe good for some voyeurs out there. Maybe that turns them on. But for me, it doesn't do anything.
Sure. How familiar do you think you are with the lore based on what you've read in the scripts, what you've done in acting, and what you've seen of Metal Gear? Do you think you could recount some things, or is it kind of fading? Or,
well, I mean, you know, I know from what I've done and right. from what I experienced, and yeah, certain moments do pop out for me.
Sure.
Certainly, you guys and others who play the games extensively. And if you're fans and you do the research, then you will know more than me. That is a fact. Right. It just is.
Sure.
But I do know what I know from my experience. And yeah, I've got stories.
Awesome. You know? I think we interviewed James Horan last week, or Horan, excuse me.
Hold on. James Horan is what it
Horan,
is.
Oh, right.
Calling me. This should have been in the off position.
That ringtone, though. I love it.
Isn't that bitching?
That's awesome.
It's the Dropkick Murphys.
Yeah. I recognize it. But, you know, when we interviewed James, you know.
But when you're Irish, you know.
We've got a ton of Irish people in the chat, and I'm sure they're very, very happy to hear that.
Oh, yeah. Well,
that's because my family, you know, originates from County Mayo, Ballina, right, west of Ireland. Then I've got cousins in the north a bit, and then over in Dublin, which is the east, right? Then I've got cousins who moved over to England. They're in Yorkshire, okay? They're up in Yorkshire, that's right. And then there's a number of us who moved to America in the Cleveland area and throughout the United States. So, right to you. Cheers, Schlancha. All the best.
Oh man, that's awesome.
The Rouen clan out there, anyway.
when we were talking to James, you know, he just did his work in The Phantom Pain, and he had already, you know, forgot a lot of the stuff, so I think, you know, we're just trying to see, you know, how familiar with your, you know, your stuff is. Granted, his part was way smaller, I'm sure, than yours. You've been in, you know, three or four different games now.
I bet his wife would not be happy to hear you say his part is way smaller.
Secrets revealed. Let's, exclusive
let's
info.
Just say this for the show, because we're going to ask James to come back on the show later. I just want to clarify that we mean his role in Metal Gear Solid.
Well, he gets it. He gets it. And so does his wife.
Wow.
Yeah, no, James is awesome. You know, I don't know if did he tell you the story of where we met?
No, yeah, in Ireland.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, he did. He did, didn't he?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the same.
What was it?
It was a Book of Kells.
Yeah, the Book of Kells. That's what it was.
Trinity College. It should have been as well. Mm-hmm. We were both in Dublin in 1999, unbeknownst to one another. It's crazy. We had the same voice agent for a number of years, Sandy Schnarr, and I walk in, and I look, James, Quentin. It was amazing. You know, it was just like right out of Metal Gear. You know, it was something unexpected, and all of a sudden these two characters came together, and you're like, oh my God, what's going to happen next? Ready for this? Coffee.
Amazing.
I know, right?
That next big step.
Swords. Yeah.
He drew swords and started battling. Yeah.
It was a great story. I really enjoyed that. And you're the one who...
With coffee sticks. Coffee sticks. Sugar, son of a bitch.
That's epic. I'm okay to watch that.
Rhoda, your next question.
All right, yeah.
What was your question? I don't even know if you gave me one.
I haven't given you one yet, but I got one for you. That let's cut to the chase on this one real fast though. I know you are quite aware of the flack that Raiden got in MGS2 after his initial, you know, reveal and stuff like that. So my question to you is, you know, what were your thoughts about that at the time?
Well, I'll be honest with you, I didn't understand it. I didn't. Someone interviewed me, and there's a silly quote that has been up on my IMDb page for years since then, because it was in some article, I think, and I'll try and quote my quote. I said something like, I wasn't aware that there was a problem. All I'm aware is there's a for and against, and that's all. And really, so it didn't hit me on a personal level because, as you know, there's a even back then, there was no virtual world like this.
Right.
And there was nobody in my community around me to come up and go, you know, I'm a huge fan of MGS1, and I love Snake, and I hate your character. Like, it didn't happen.
Jeez.
So it didn't happen. So it didn't I wasn't bothered by it. I didn't understand it.
Right.
And eventually I did, because what happened is, you know, Hideo Kojima was pretty clever in that he created a story and he created a character that was to be a surprise.
Mm. Yeah.
Well, probably unbeknownst to him and myself and I guess others, would be this big backlash where they're like, no, we want to work through Snake. Who is this fucking writing? That's the voice they all use.
Exactly.
Bingo. You hit it.
You know, damn. So I just went, well, you know, eventually they'll like it. And if they don't, that's okay. Because, you know, the best press is any press, good or bad. So as long as they're talking, you know. And then Metal Gear 4 happened. So you know what happened after that. I'll leave that to you guys.
Yeah, that was, it was, you know, I think just my personal opinion on it is I don't think people were necessarily angry with you or, you know, the voice. I think they were, it was just offset to, you know, go from the gritty Snake to a skinny blonde
guy. The newbie, you know, girly looking.
Yeah.
Which
it was weird.
I point out, like, constantly that Raiden is actually a badass, but he's just forgotten about it. You know what I mean? So,
it's
he may seem like up front, you know, he doesn't know what he's doing. He's the rookie, but you know, he's probably killed just as many people as Snake.
Yeah, I think towards the end, you really get to understand the character a lot more. I think towards the end, people tend to like Raiden, but people who don't finish the game per se, maybe they're left with that feeling of, hey, I want to play a Snake. But I think towards the end, everyone kind of always they're like, hey, you know, he's all right, he's all right.
They came around. It took a while, you know.
Yeah.
But it's like with anything. I mean, change. You know, people in general, they don't like change, and the knee-jerk reaction is a reaction. It usually comes from fear and anger. That comes later. It's like, what? as opposed to pausing and going, all right, why don't I try this something new? Let's just see how it tastes.
Right.
Exactly. All right, well, I think that leads into to my next question. And that is, what are your thoughts after playing Metal or being in Metal Gear Solid 2, 4? You did the cameo face in Raiden's face was in Metal Gear Solid 3. You know, so you've worked with David. What was your reaction to David not being in the new upcoming game?
It was this.
We had the same reaction up front, but a lot of people have since said that, and Paul Eiding included, when talking to Chris Zimmerman, said that, you know, Kiefer does a good job at, you know, being big boss. But, I mean, working with David Hayter, like, you know, we did for just the short time interview, you get kind of, he's an attaching kind of guy. Like, you know, after you work with him, you're like, David, that's my man. And, you know, obviously we all want him to be in the game. Did you have an opinion on that?
Yeah. In fact, you know, a petition went around. You guys maybe were aware of that at the time?
No.
So, not only did I sign, I wrote a letter of support for David. And
awesome. I had no idea you did that.
Oh, I did, yeah. Because he's brilliant. He's a good friend. I love him. And he deserves the role. He originated it.
Right.
Whatever decisions were made. Sorry.
No, you're fine. We're just lagging a little bit. You're okay.
Okay, good. So so I supported that, and then whatever decisions were made, as we know in any kind of business, there's more to the story that we don't know.
Right.
So it had to be some kind of a business decision. Why? I don't know. I don't know that I'll ever know. And only David knows, Hideo knows. They probably know more than Kiefer knows.
Probably.
Yeah. You
know, like, he got the job, and I'm sure he was happy to do it. I've not heard what he's done at all. I don't have any inside information.
Right.
He's Kiefer Sutherland, so I can imagine what it'll sound like. I'm sure he'll be fine, but whatever.
Right. Sounds like Jack Bauer, if you've watched 24.
Exactly.
You can't get that out of your head. Yeah. Take some time, yeah.
What are your guys' thoughts on it?
So far, I think it's definitely a more kind of subdued performance, whereas David has that sort of iconic voice that you kind of instantly recognize. With Kiefer, it's more of a, you know, because one of the things they're doing now is facial capture. So yes. What they wanted to do was tell more with what is in the face rather than, you know, having to say certain things. So, for example, if Snake is angry, he doesn't, you know, you don't want him to be like, I'm angry, you know. Want him to just have that face, which Kiefer can do with the facial capture, and then have that show the players that he's angry instead of. So that's their goal, and I think that's why they chose Kiefer, because he doesn't just do voice, he also does like the acts, yeah. You know, facial and whatever.
Yeah. And I'm going to contradict you on that.
Because David's an actor.
And trust me, acting is acting. Don't let anybody tell you anything different. When you're acting with voice, you know, you have a certain set of skills, a particular set of skills and tools.
I will find you.
And
that's great.
So there's that. There's acting for the stage, which is big. There's acting for TV, which is smaller. There's acting for film, which is less. Yeah. Because you have this, there's far less to do. And David could have done it just quite as capable of a job. I'm telling you, I believe it's a business decision that has to do with commerce more than anything else.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah.
Because ultimately, it's not going to be Kiefer's face.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, what I told you was just there, what they said to the people. That's what they said. You know, they want to show the face. And that's what they said. So I don't actually know why.
That's what they tell us.
That's the same face that I gave them, Quentin. Ronan, what's your opinion on it?
I don't know. Like, we haven't really seen too much of his voice work in the game so far, so it's kind of hard to throw out a general opinion about it just yet.
He had like less than 8 minutes of dialogue.
From what we've seen at least, so you know, it's hard to say.
He does a good job though, and but every time he yells or says "damn it," you know, I'm just like, that's Jack Bauer.
Yeah, like 24.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah. So, someone takes place between. Yeah.
You guys know me. I'm the rough around the edges one in the group. So my personal opinion on it, Quentin, was the only way that I'll be okay with it, and the only way I think I'll enjoy it is if David comes back and plays Solid Snake, as we know, Big Boss is, you know, different than Solid Snake, and he has a different voice actor in Metal Gear Solid 4. I forget the guy's name off the top of my head.
Yeah.
But
Doyle, something Doyle.
Doyle. Richard Doyle.
Doyle played Big Boss at the end of Metal Gear Solid 4. David played Solid Snake, and they have, you know, the father-son moment or whatever. And I think that's the only way that I'm ever going to be okay with that decision to change out the voice actor. I mean, this deep in the last game, like, why not have David? You know what I mean? So that's my opinion.
I miss the voice. That's all I'll definitely say for sure.
I want to say I appreciate what Kiefer Sutherland does, because we do want him to come on the show, and I don't want him to hate me before he gets on the show.
Well, Kiefer, you may not know me, but I love you, buddy. I'm a big fan. And I do also know Kiefer's a musician.
Yeah.
Tell me about the club he has. I don't know if he still has it. But look, everything I've gotten from Kiefer, as far as an actor and interviews I've seen, you know, he just seems like a stand-up guy, a genuine guy. So I'm sure he's going to do quite a capable performance. You know, and I don't have any problem with him. I have no resentment towards him whatsoever. It's a decision that is above and beyond us. And that's what happens in this business. Right. Yeah. I've replaced actors. Actors have replaced me. It's just a part of the game.
Right.
Awesome. Sure.
All right. Well, Young, you're up.
Yep. So my next question is about, I don't know if you remember the final moments of Metal Gear Solid 2, where everything just kind of starts going crazy. Do you remember that recording for that? So my question to you is, how closely did you work with Paul Eiding, who was doing the Colonel, who was going crazy because he's an AI, and he was saying all this crazy stuff? So were you guys in the same room, or did he record his lines and then you recorded yours? How was that exchange done?
Are you talking about the codec stuff?
Yeah, the codec stuff where he's like, turn off your video game console, and he starts saying some random stuff, like he's glitching.
You know, of course Paul and I work together. What I don't know is whether or not they pulled him aside and had some separate sessions with him. Okay. What I remember mostly about Metal Gear Solid 2 is I did get to work with pretty much everybody that I interacted with in the game.
Oh, cool.
That's awesome. Nice.
Whereas in later installments, by like Metal Gear Solid 4, sometimes there were people, let's say Raiden would interact with, but not as much, they might record separately. But if there was denser dialogue, like with me and Vamp, of course we were together. Right. But yeah, Paul and I worked together, and some of the stuff he said to me was hilarious. It was brilliant, you know, and it was wacky, and it was nutty, and all kinds of shit's going down. It's a shit storm, you know. Did you understand? What are you doing? Get your head out of your ass, you know. I got it.
Yeah.
I mean, I got it. Whatever you want, I'll do cartwheels naked. But, you know, I have no unit.
Oh, man.
I'm like a Ken doll.
Did you actually... Did you understand the stuff towards the end, like why that stuff was happening, or did you just kind of go along with the flow?
I just went with the flow, baby. I just, you know, I read what was on the page. They told me what to do. They explained the situation, and then I went with it, you know?
Sure.
It's all about playing. It really is. And, no, we had a great time, and I know Paul said this in his interview, and I'll say it again. We're both a couple of guys originally from Cleveland. There's a lot of us out here, but we didn't meet until we were here in the business, which is a trip.
Right.
Sure.
And I saw a bongo in behind him in his interview with you guys, so I assume Paul must be a musician, just like I am.
Right.
A lot of other guys. Yeah.
You know, it's funny. Speaking of the naked cartwheel, I played MGS2 when I was a kid. So when that moment arrived, I didn't know what to think about that. I was a little disturbed. I was like, I don't know if I can keep playing this. Like it's an interesting sight to behold, but it was really funny though.
It is. Well, it is funny, and when you're young, it's weird. It's like it doesn't make any sense. In fact, as an adult, I wonder what was Hideo thinking.
Like imagine having your mom there sitting there watching it with you, because that's where I was when I played it. Yeah, that was
seriously.
When I was a kid, that was something else.
That's awkward.
Yeah, was very.
There at that moment when that happened.
Yes, she was right. She was there watching at that moment, and she tried. She took it in stride. I was surprised and I was impressed at the time. But you know those moments where sometimes you kind of have to do the naked cartwheels.
Yeah,
that's when things got a little awkward.
Yeah. No one should have to do a naked cartwheel. I've not. Just for me, guys. There's not been a moment in my life where I've had to do the naked cartwheel. If I had the skills and the ability, I might choose to, but it's not going to look very good.
You're still young. You got plenty of time to do all the naked cartwheels.
I'm young, but I'm not young.
Oh, there you go.
True.
I think the fans would rather see Young do it than me.
You know what? Well, his fans, I wouldn't be surprised. His fans love him to death, man.
I'll practice. It'll happen one day. I'll send you a link.
You know, he does your voice imitations. It might be good for you to pick up the cartwheel, man. We should do that. We're gonna get a petition signed.
Yeah, take the next step, you know.
Do an strongly worded letter to your agent, you know, about getting me.
I wish I had an agent.
Ronan, was that the end of your? Or did you have another question?
Yeah, I had a question coming up, but I want to make sure that we were still caught up on all the other ones first.
Yeah, I think it's your turn.
Okay, just making sure. Yep. All right, so going from MGS2 to MGS4, you know, Raiden, he's gone through some significant changes, let's say, in terms of his character and stuff like that. So what was your approach in changing his demeanor going from naked cartwheel Raiden to battle-hardened badass cyborg ninja Raiden in MGS4?
It's funny, that's kind of the way I describe him when people would ask. He's a world-weary, war-torn cyborg ninja.
Nice.
So, not unlike what you just said. Well, what happened differently in that, as you know, vocally, is, you know, his voice changed because his balls dropped. And that's what happens when one goes through puberty.
Myth confirmed.
Yeah, so that's what happened. And if I remember correctly, yes, I had to re-audition for the role. Yeah, I did. And I thought, oh, okay, whatever. And I guess, you know, Chris knew I could do it. She just had to show, you know, the other folks who were producing and writing and creating that, yes, he has the ability to do this and give us the changes that we need. So, again, it came down to where is this guy today? What does he sound like? You know, what has happened? And as you've just astutely pointed out, you know, that is the perfect definition of what happened to this guy,
right?
And where he is today, you know, he's gone through hell and back, and he's a world weary, war torn cyborg ninja. So that had to apply not only to my acting, but it was their choice to drop the voice. It wasn't mine.
Right.
I was quite happy to do it because I love, you know, changing voices. That's what we do as voice actors. It's, you know,
yeah,
it's my love since I was 8, so I'm happy to do it now.
Right, sure.
And then the fact that there was this duplicitous nature was even better. I was like, wow, you know, it's almost like getting two characters in one.
That's nice.
By
that's
any awesome. Chance, did the feedback from MGS2 have anything to do with the change in voice? Do you know if maybe they thought they want a more, I guess, badass character for Raiden, so maybe we should change the voice to something more gritty, you know, down here instead of up here? You know, was that a factor?
That I wouldn't know, quite honestly, because that was, you know, it's a good question. You'd have to ask Hideo Kojima, and I don't think he speaks English.
No.
Do you speak Japanese or anybody there?
No, unfortunately.
I'm sure we could get a translator. If we got Hideo Kojima there, I would.
I know a translator.
I could get a translator for sure.
Like, I know one that would definitely want to help out in that situation for sure.
But
so.
Quite honestly, I don't know. They didn't tell me, and it wasn't for me. It's almost like you know, being a part of a secret organization or the FBI or the CIA on a need-to-know basis. Need-to-know basis, Raiden.
That's it. That's what everyone says, all the actors. They're like, yeah, we. A lot of the times they won't get story information because that's so secretive until it's in the moment. And that to me is crazy. I don't think a lot of companies or a lot of studios do that.
Yeah, kind of like at the end of MGS4 where Rose shows up with Raiden's son.
Oh yeah!
I didn't see that coming. I had no idea. I mean, literally, I don't even remember having sex with her.
nobody does.
No, that's what I'm making sure. Because I don't know how much he looks like.
Shots really. Fired, man.
I was like, let's do a paternity test, okay? Let's put this thing to rest. I think you're a money-grubbing whore, and you're trying to climb the socioeconomic ladder, okay? That's what this is about.
I'll be out of white hair. I thought about her at first, but showed up with Colonel Campbell in 4. I'm like, oh,
yeah,
shit.
Yeah, right? Paul, you jerk.
Yeah, I think it was Colonel Campbell and Rosie got it on. Yeah. So, let's be honest. Wow. He's just shirking his responsibilities. He's putting it off on me again. Let's put Raiden out there. Let's make him responsible. I'm going to sit in my glass in her ivory tower and watch.
I have to make sure that Paul Eiding sees this part of the interview. Quentin Flynn, everybody. Quentin Flynn.
Real quick, to go back to the previous question, would you say that was the same case, like in terms of the direction for Raiden going from MGS4 to Metal Gear Rising? Is it that? Would you say it's still the same?
Yeah, it wasn't that much different as far as I was concerned. Going to Rising, it's just that this was his baby, right?
Yeah.
And but again, I do remember with that, I might have said this before, or maybe it was at a different interview, where, you know, there were times that Chris would have to, you know, go like, you know, regular Raiden.
Yeah,
right, yeah.
Jack the Ripper. Regular Raiden, Jack the Ripper. You know, as a reminder, depending on what dialogue we were reading, because sometimes we'd skip scene to scene, or I would read something and I would think, well, it must be this way.
Sure.
And it's like, no. Let me give you the backstory. Okay. Because a lot of it was happening really quickly.
Yeah.
And in doing it, when, like, you know, you had Phil LaMarr interviewed, and I just remember us specifically doing our scenes, you know, we had the copy in front of us, and let's say there'd be 2.5 pages of dialogue. We might run through it once, just a general run through, and she'd give us quick directions and notes on each, and then she'd be like, okay, record and go. Mm-hmm. And then Phil and I immediately would have to embrace the scene, start acting it with one another, acting it out with one another. That sounds wrong. So we would do the scene, and then it would be over. And they moved at a rapid rate. And if they liked most or all of it, they would keep it. If they needed to make any changes, they might say, "Okay, let's do a pickup on line 47," and then give the different direction.
Right.
So that's kind of how that worked.
Okay.
I hope that answers your
question. Oh, no, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Thanks.
Good.
All right. My next question is actually switching topics a little bit. I'm curious how you went from, you know, playing Spider-Man to Venom and why the change, and how did you like playing Venom better than Spider-Man? Because I got to be honest with you, Quentin. My side job is reviewing games, and I hate all Spider-Man games except for those. those Spider-Man games were like the only good ones in the whole Spider-Man universe so far. So I'm curious what your opinion on was playing them, and did you like playing the villain better?
Well, those are like three questions. I'm going to try and answer them all.
I'll recap at any point if you need to.
Oh, no, I got it.
I got a script.
Marvel's Ultimate Alliance, I played Spider-Man.
Yeah.
And Friend or Foe, I played Venom. And as you said, those two were probably they are definitely the best Spider-Man games ever put out there.
They definitely are.
Unparalleled. And that's because I was in them.
Boom.
Let's be honest. Huh? Come on.
Boom.
The new Spider-Man is terrible. I don't know if you've played it, but it's not good. Or seen it. It's not good. Like, whatsoever.
Look, this is just my opinion. First of all, I'll answer your question. I was blessed to be cast as Spider-Man because he was my all-time favorite superhero from the time I was a little boy. Always played him. Always pretended to be him. Be sitting in the back of my parents' car, and Dad would be driving. Yeah, my mom's in the front. My brother Bart and I are in the back. And as we're driving, and I'm seeing like street lamps up ahead, up above, I'm going like this, like, and I'm imagining I'm pulling our car along. I was in that world, man.
That's awesome.
I loved it. And then in the summers of Ohio, it got we'd get kind of muggy and a bit humid, so your feet would get a bit tacky. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so I'd get in the door jamb, and I would hold the side of it and put my back against it, and I would climb up as a little boy to the top where my head would just hit the top of the door jamb, and I was like, I'm Spider-Man.
Yes, you are.
So, and I became Spider-Man. Unfortunately, I didn't have any webbing because I couldn't go any further than that. You know, I was like, Dad, I'm Spider-Man. He's like, yes, you are, son. Now do your homework. So, so I did that, and so to get that role was awesome. Because, again, he was my favorite character, and here's why. Out of all the superheroes out there, Spider-Man is the only one who is a cynic and has a sense of humor, is sardonic and sarcastic, and he's like a stand-up comedian superhero.
So he's when you, basically.
Done, it fits you good.
Me, basically me. Exactly. That's why I say I am the best, and that is all with all humility, because I understand the character. And if you saw the 60s series, you know, if you've watched any of it, and you must if you haven't, the series they did, the animated series in the 60s, for my money, that actor captured the essence of Spider-Man and his sarcasm. The music of that series is bitchin'. It's amazing music, great visuals for the time, and it reflects exactly who the character of Spider-Man is and was in Marvel Comics. That is what I believe, that's what I tried to replicate. That's right. What writers need to do when they're writing the character. That's what they didn't have with Tobey Maguire. Even though I enjoyed that. The follow-up, live-action Spider-Man, I enjoyed him as well a bit more, probably because Garfield. Of the effects. Sorry?
The one with Garfield?
Yeah, the Brit, yeah?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
He was great, and I thought that was really, really cool. Mm-hmm. But I do think they missed the mark because they have Spider-Man kind of like, you know, generic, kind of milquetoast.
Right, yeah.
Man, he's got an edge to him. And then when they make him Peter Parker, don't make him this nebbishy weakling nerd. I mean, if you read the comics, you know, he was a scientist. He was a photographer. Sure, he had a little bit of low self-esteem, but he wasn't a wimp.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the way they played him. So, that answers that, I think. Venom goes, that was a whole other creation, right? And it was like, oh my God, and he's part of Spider-Man, but he's not, but he is. And, you know, and he's a menace, and it's almost like Spider-Man fighting his dark side.
Yeah,
right. Sure. Right. Absolutely.
That's how I took it, so obviously we're on the same page there. Yeah. So for me to be able to do Venom, yes! I mean, that's awesome. When I went in to do Venom, I'm like, this is what this mofo needs. Like, he needs to be a badass. I mean, you see that tongue.
Yeah.
You see the teeth. You feel the grit. You're like, I must be Master Kill Spider-Man. And I could be wrong, but I think maybe James Arnold Taylor was the voice of Spider-Man in Friend or Foe opposite me. I'm not positive. Okay.
I think about that one too. Not sure.
I saw a clip the other day, and I thought it was James because I'm pretty good with voices. And what I'm doing right now is I'm taking a moment to show you all.
Oh man!
Oh, that's awesome!
Oh man!
This is what I'm talking about, people. That is And that's something I will awesome. Bring out to conventions. But that is, you know, that's me. I told people, I actually end up fighting myself. I've gotten to voice these two iconic roles, and I love them both. Again, Spidey is, he's closer to me. Okay. When I get to be me and my voice, and I get to have some funny lines to deliver, nice cutting edge, funny, let's have a laugh, and let's kick some ass. But then Venom also, you know, who doesn't get angry and who doesn't want to be like, I want to kill you? Yeah. You know, because we do have those moments in our life where we're all like pissed off and we do want to kill someone. I mean, not literally, because none of us, I hope, are sociopaths.
Right.
But in playing, because as children we all played, and that's what it's about. You know, even gaming is playing. But as we all did as kids, and we all have these wonderful imaginations, and in our fantasy minds, you know, whether you want to be Darth Vader, Venom, or Spider-Man, Luke Skywalker, you have that, and you want to play it. And for when you bring it to life.
Yeah.
And when we do that, whether we're children, or we're playing a game, or we're illustrating, or we're acting as I've done in these roles, that's what's happening, and there's nothing like it, man. It's like a dream realized, and they capture it, and then they animate it, and then they put it out there, and then everybody gets to play through it and be it and do it. And so if you like those two, then my friend, I have done my job.
Yes, they were they were awesome, man. I loved those characters, and you know, as you said, I like Spider-Man too, just as much as probably just as much as you do. Is really, really one of my favorite, you know, comic book heroes. But I really liked Venom too. Was my probably my favorite villain of the, you know, that series.
Yeah, he's bitching, man.
They should cast you for the new Marvel Spider-Man.
Are they? Yeah, I agree.
There's a new one coming out. Marvel got the rights or whatever, and now they're including it with the Avengers storyline and stuff like that. So,
buddy, make a call, okay? That's what I'm saying. You out there, any of you heavyweights out there, cast me.
Quentin Spider-Man. Petition. Let's get a petition going around.
And I'll do cartwheels in a Spidey suit so you don't see my junk.
All right, Young, you have the next question?
Sure. So, my next question to you is, as you know, after the events of MGS4, Snake eventually, he got sick and he eventually, you know, passed away. He got old, and I don't know if you know this. But yeah, so he passed away eventually. So how do you think Raiden dealt with that after the events of MGS4?
Well, fan fiction here.
Yeah.
Well, if you go into fan fiction, someone would probably say, oh, he masturbated furiously into a hat.
Yeah, there are those fans. I
think that canon. Why not?
Yeah, right. But one might say that. You know, depending on how much humanity, you know, he has, it depends on how he would be affected. You know, I'm sure it would, you know, be devastating. You know, as a loss is to anybody. I'm sure also that he would take along what he learned from Snake with him, and you know. Try, as we do when we learn from others, try to take the best bits, you know, and carry on. Sure. And then I would say that sometimes there would be reminders for him in his life of Snake through others, where it's like, oh, wait a minute. I got to do the right thing. Right. You know, I better not lose control. I need to handle this. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think, it, you know, a life lesson like for us all when we lose anybody in our life, you know, a parent, an older brother, an aunt, an uncle, a sibling, a mother, you know, there is definitely, you can't live and not react.
Sure.
And not be affected. And I think for him, you know, it probably would turn into a greater conviction. Certainly he would have anger about it. He would act out, as many people do, myself included, when you're in a hurt place. And then he would find the balance when somebody speaks reasonably to him and maybe to his more rational self.
I feel like that kind of shows through in like Metal Gear Rising, where he's in a better place now. He's a little more, he's not as depressed. He knows kind of where he stands. And I think I actually really like that, where Snake kind of, his death might have maybe given him a little more, as you said, he took a lot from what Snake taught him. And I feel like that kind of shows through a bit in Metal Gear Rising. I don't know if that was a conscious thing from the writer's part, but to me that makes a lot of sense. So thank you for that answer.
Yeah. No, you're welcome. And also, the nice thing, too, is there's a sense of humor, you know, when he's got, well, this would be a spoiler for anyone who hasn't played it, but the sombrero and the...
yeah, poncho, whatever you call it.
Yeah,
yeah, you know, and, you know, when he's reporting back to Kevin, who, of course, is Phil LaMarr.
Yeah.
I believe he's speaking to Kevin in Kodak, if I'm not mistaken. Maybe it was not, but I think it was. And he's like, it was, yeah, and he's like, you know, they'll never recognize me. I've got a full disguise on. Yeah, cyborg ninja, yeah. Walking around with this gaudy sombrero. I mean, it's not like a subtle thing. No. It's this big, and you know, the only thing it's missing is, you know, like, I don't know. It's almost like a pinata on his head. It's that ridiculous.
And the poncho is very colorful too.
Yeah,
I know. This sombrero has so many colors. It's like you look like a Macy's Day Parade, dude. A cyborg Macy's Day Parade. We know you're not from here. We know you're from somewhere else.
So and then he says, like, "Adios, amigos," or whatever.
Exactly. It's brilliant.
I thought that was hilarious.
And he's there with Wolfie. But he could, what are you going to do with Wolfie? I don't know. He should have put a sombrero on Wolfie.
Yep, there you go.
Well, they needed that game.
It's so over the top that I think it all just fits together really nicely and makes everything
work. You need some parts to laugh at in between you being very upset from dying all the time because it's so hard.
I know. Yeah, that gets a little old.
Ronan, your next question for Mr. Flynn.
All right, so this next question I typically tend to ask all the actors and actresses about in terms of MGS. So my question to you is, you know, what is it about the series as a whole that keeps you reprising your role as Raiden, in your opinion?
Their need for me, to be honest. You know, like, yeah, I mean, the role comes... what do I believe is their reason or my reason?
Your reason.
Oh, yeah, my reason for reprising the role, or reprising, depending on how you want to say it, is that I love the role. You know, I'm happy to do it anytime. Create an animated series. I'll do it. I'll do 48 episodes in a season. I'll do 120 in a season. I'll do as many as you like because I love this character. Right. So as long as they're willing to have me back and care as you guys want, as long as they want. So it's up to them, though, because they got to create it.
Right,
and I'm just waiting. You know, like after we did Rising Revengeance, you know, I said to one of the creators who was a writer, producer, I said, any thoughts on the sequel? He's like, yeah, we do. We have some thoughts on a sequel. I said,
oh, wow.
Any thoughts of when it might be? And we recorded in 2012, if I'm not mistaken. And I thought he said maybe a couple of years. So I had assumed incorrectly that we might be recording in 2014, and that didn't happen. Mm-hmm. And then I thought, well, certainly they're developing things. God bless you.
Thank you.
And then I found out the information not long ago about Hideo Kojima and Konami and that split. And then I went, oh, no.
Oh, yeah. Same here. Everyone. That was this unified cry from all the Metal Gear
fans. Oh, yeah.
Because they knew what was going to happen after that. You know, no more Metal Gear Solid, no more Metal Gear Rising, and now the stuff, you know, Silent Hills, that's been canceled. I don't know what that's about. But.
And I actually met up with the three women Silent Hill nurses when I was in Calgary, Canada.
That was awesome. I saw the picture.
And did you see that picture? Yeah. Amazing. Yeah. They were amazing. They were so in character. They were absolutely silent. When they left the room, they did that really awkward walk.
Oh, jeez. Yeah.
Nice.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
It was genius.
Awesome.
So I was very excited about that, and for obvious reasons. Now, the coming together of both, that's what I would like. I would like Raiden and the Nurses of Metal Gear to have a series called Silent Revengeance.
There we go.
I'd like the name you just said, Raiden and the Nurses of Metal Gear. Like, that would be a very...
Is that what I said?
That's what it should be.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. But I do wonder, and I guess it's because I'm hopeful, that maybe, you know, because I don't know anything about the rights. I don't know if Konami owns the rights, and they're like, it's done, you can't have it, you'll never do it.
Right.
Or we have the rights, and we're going to do it with somebody else. Or Kojima has worked a deal where he can go on to do it somewhere else with someone else. Right. So these are the questions I have, and I hope that they will do it again.
The official word is that Konami's going to retain the rights, and they're going to make, they're hiring right now, actually, for what they're calling a new Metal Gear series. So, yeah, they're moving on with the Metal Gear series without Kojima, and Kojima, he's, I guess he's going to do his own thing from now on. That's the official word for now.
That actually leads into my next question, and I wanted to ask you, what is your opinion on that situation? And then the sub-question to that is, say Konami does retain the rights and ask you to return as Raiden, would you do it without Kojima?
First question was, what are my thoughts on...
Yeah, that whole, the situation between them.
The rights?
No, your thoughts on the Konami-Kojima situation, how
the debacle going on there.
They seem to be basically firing him or letting him go.
Yeah, well, I find it unfortunate, like anything, you know, it's a breakup. And, you know, who wants mommy and daddy to divorce? No one. So, I, you know, it's a drag, and but again, I'm only a child. They're not letting me know what the real story is.
Right.
When I grow up someday, maybe I'll be able to find the papers. So there's that. I don't know anything about it to be able to comment on it. And as far as Konami going on without him, and should they like to hire me to reprise the role, absolutely I'll do it.
Well, I think that's a good thing, because we don't want the series to die. Obviously, all of us want Hideo Kojima in the directorial role of those games. Right. But if that's how the world has to be, you know, we're all adults here. We understand, you know, business, people make bad business decisions, and people make good business decisions, and then people make the decisions that they want to. We understand that. I wouldn't want to see, you know, such a good series die both sides of the spectrum just because they don't have, you know, Hideo Kojima, which obviously, like I said, we would like him to be there, but if we can't have him, I wouldn't want to see those games flushed down the toilet.
Right.
I would neither. And I would hope that whatever Hideo goes on to produce in the future, that when it's brought over to America for us to do, that I might be right for a different kind of role.
Right.
To also, you know, because hopefully he has interest in...
Did you get to work with him a lot?
I didn't get to work with him at all.
Really?
No, I never met the man. Wow. I was just going to say, I'm hoping that he has an interest in the English-speaking produced games and likes what we've done, and I hope he likes what I've done as an actor. So that's why I'm saying, should he have any say in the future, it would be great to be able to work for him on a different project. And as far as Raiden goes and the Metal Gear series, to me it's just like the James Bond series or Sherlock Holmes. You know, it's a character, it's a story that I think needs to continue and needs to be developed. And if that means bringing in additional people, hopefully they'll honor the character, the story, and continue it forward in such a way that everybody gets excited. Like today's Daniel Craig's James Bond, amazing to me.
Right.
And BBC's Sherlock, starring Benedict Cumberbatch, is amazing. In the same way that as a young boy I was amazed by Basil Rathbone's Sherlock Holmes and Nigel Bruce, who played Dr. Watson. You know, and those were the old black and white films.
Yeah.
Those are brilliant. And if nobody's seen them, you must look them up. Sherlock Holmes, Nigel Bruce and Basil Rathbone. And if you haven't seen BBC's Sherlock with Benedict Cumberbatch and Martin Freeman, who many people say I remind them of, you should watch that as well.
Well, there you go. Well, I'll tell you, just before we move on to the next question, I'll tell you, I watched an interview with Hideo Kojima after Metal Gear Solid 2, and he said he loved what you did as Raiden, and Raiden was one of his favorite characters in the Metal Gear series. So I know.
Wow.
There you go.
You got that support. That was, I believe that was released a couple years ago. There's a big documentary where he talks about all of the games and stuff like that.
Oh, right, yeah.
Yeah, and, you know, a lot of people outside of Kojima said that Kojima sees himself as Raiden.
Cool.
I think
he loves doing the naked cartwheel. I don't know if you know.
Basically, that's the highlight.
I'm pretty sure David Hayter said that in our interview, that Kojima sees himself as Raiden. I have to go back and watch that, but I'm fairly sure he said that.
David would know, because David has had communication with him, and you know, is definitely steeped, you know, in this, the way in which that series has developed probably more than anybody else. Well, definitely in the English-speaking world, let's put it that way. Certainly here in Hollywood.
All right. So, Yong, your next question?
So, my next question to you is, what would you say is your favorite role you've done ever? I know that...
They always ask me a question.
Oh, really?
I guest at a lot of conventions, and I travel, and that question is always asked. And I always want to have an answer, but usually it's the character I'm playing at the time.
Sure.
Because, again, I like to be here now, and like whatever moment I'm in, hopefully I find some magical moments in that.
Kalthias, right?
Prince Kalthias.
Yeah. Does that Prince? Stay with one right now?
Well, yeah, because there's a nice little trailer out there, and the game's out, and it's current. So if anybody goes, what are you working on? I'm like, well, look, I got this out.
Okay. Well, to narrow the question down then, which of the Raidens do you prefer voicing? Do you like young Metal Gear Solid 2 Raiden, Cyborg Metal Gear Solid 4 Raiden, or maybe Jack the Ripper Metal Gear Revengeance Raiden?
Well, I mean, of course, Revengeance has both. You know, maybe more Jack the Ripper, but, you know, I get to be, you remember me sitting in the back of the limo with the president, right? And that's me. I'm very rock and roll with the sunglasses, the hair.
Right.
Yep. I approve. What a dandy is, right? Yeah.
Very Quentin.
Very cool. Kind of a mix of glam and mod. I like it.
That's I really thought that was the voice that was going to come out of him at that time.
I know, me too. I'd hope. But, I think Revengeance is what I dig the most, you know, that blend of Raiden. I think it's a delicious blend. I think we should be able to buy it at Starbucks or any coffee house.
the Raiden blend.
The Raiden blend.
Yeah. So,
lightning. You
know, lightning in a cup.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. There we go.
But you're a lightning in a cup. Get the Raiden blend. So I like, I do love Raiden, and I love playing that role because I get to do, I would say, probably of all my characters, he is my favorite next to Spider-Man because I've gotten to do so much as an actor. I've gotten to cover the full range of emotions and spectrum that I have as an artist, and I was honored by BTVA in getting... the best male performance in a lead role in a video game for Metal Gear Rising Revengeance as Raiden. I got a BTVA award.
Nice.
Wow, nice.
So that's pretty amazing. You know, that's the first honor that I've received as an actor. And to get it for that says a lot.
Yeah.
Especially because at that time, I was going through a difficult time in my life personally. And I remember thinking, am I going to be able to carry this off professionally?
Right.
Am I going to be able to do the best work that I need to do? And it turns out, apparently,
yeah,
because they voted and they said, this was the best male lead vocal performance in a video game for 2014. So
it was good. We were just talking about the dialogue while I was playing it. Man, I really liked, the direction of the writing, and then it always makes it so much more, like, down to earth when you have a voice actor who understands that, and you really brought that script that they wrote to life, and I think you did a really good job on that. So congratulations on that, by the way. I know we're a little late on it, but
it's all right.
Congratulations on that.
No, it's good because, you know, there's people who don't know.
Yeah, well,
yeah.
That's true.
No,
did you have any other parts for that question?
Let's see. No, that's pretty much it.
So. All right, Ronan. Before you go, Ronan, Quentin, I just want to make sure we're about to hit our hour marker. Are you okay for time?
Okay,
perfect.
Awesome.
All right.
Good.
Take it away, Ronan.
All right, so this question is going to dive a little bit into some of your other work in another franchise that you're known for. So, as many know, you are Axel, or Lee, in the Kingdom Hearts series. So, can you talk a little bit about, you know, how you ended up getting the role as Axel? Like, what you know, the story leading up to that, how did that go?
I pick up the phone. I said, I hear you guys are casting for the part of Axel. They go, yeah. I go, that's me. So just... I'll be in to record next week.
They're like, okay.
That's simple. That's really how it works.
Oh, wow.
All the interviews you've had, I'm pretty sure every actor says that. I auditioned for it like I do any other role, and I happened to get it because I was the right guy for the role. I was the right fit for Axel. Yeah. And again, when I started that video game series, just like Metal Gear, I had no idea that it would carry on. I had no idea. And I thought this, you know, combination of Disney and Square Enix was bizarre. Because when I saw, like, these classic Disney characters with these, you know, anime-like style characters, I was like, how is this going to work? Like, it doesn't make sense to me.
I think that's what people, that's what drew people in, this bizarre blend. And they're like, hey, I got to try this out at least. And I think they liked
it. Worked on me at least. Yeah.
And that'll be the second coffee that we sell, Bizarre Blend. Yeah. So, yeah, and then eventually Leak, you know, came down the line, and they wanted me to go from, you know, Axel being in here, like, Roxas, come on, let's do this thing, Roxas. What do you mean? To younger Lee. Hey, man, you know me? Yeah, got it memorized. So it was really, and I only know that because I went back and watched some playthroughs the other day.
Yeah,
I'm like, oh, that's right. They really did young him up a bit as Lee. And I was at the convention in Calgary again just recently, and there was a young woman dressed as Lee. And but I was doing this Q&A panel, and just I was asked a question about Kingdom Hearts, like you just asked me. And as I'm answering it, I went, "Was you know, because Axel's right here." And she corrected me right quickly. Actually, I'm Lee. And I looked. And then I remembered, oh, you're right, because the hair is the same, but the scarf, right? Yeah. There's that iconic scarf that Lee has,
right.
And she wasn't wearing the cloak. So I had to go, right, sorry, you know what I mean? whereas in Canada, you would say, sorry, okay?
Sorry, yeah.
Sorry. Sorry. Sorry.
So yeah, so I suited up, I showed up, I got the role, and man, chain kept a rolling. And people keep asking me, like, what do you know about Kingdom Hearts 3? I'm like, not a damn thing. What do you know? Like, I'm ready. Put me in. Again, I'm ready, coach. Put me in. Let's do this thing.
Right.
So I'm just waiting.
And I know, I believe like a year or so ago, I think, Haley Joel Osment said that they had already contacted him about voice work for Kingdom Hearts 3.
I think I read something about that.
Yeah.
Did he get in trouble?
He might have. I'm not sure. I didn't get the follow up for that, but yeah, I heard. Yeah. I heard about that at least. I was wondering if it might have been the same case for you, but you already answered that question. So, anyways, yeah, thanks for that.
They haven't. I don't know if it did with him or if he just saw dead people.
Oh, oh man,
Quinn, you are amazing, man. I gotta tell you, you are hilarious. my next question is. I don't know how to word this properly because we love you. We love David. Was it ever awkward when doing Metal Gear Solid 2 to be the main guy and kind of David Hayter's now supporting you? Was that ever weird between you guys that it would be like, Raiden, taking my role?
Not a problem for me. Yeah, no, not at all. It was great. It was awesome. And the way it should be, let's be honest. No, you know, it was never a problem. In fact, it was never discussed. It just wasn't. Really? You're the first person to bring it up to me.
That's what we're trying to do. We ask different questions here.
Yeah.
I know you and David are friends. You know, we've heard that from a lot of other people, yourself included, that, you know, you guys are friends, but I was curious about, you know, that first encounter doing you know, Metal Gear Solid 2. Was it, just didn't know if it might have been weird to have, you know, the star of the first game come in and now be the kind of co-star to you. Granted, he does have a lot of talking parts through the codec, and he has a lot of cut scenes and stuff like that. So it by far wasn't, you know, a diminished role. It was just, you know, now he's the co-star, you're the action star. So I'm curious if there was ever any kind of awkwardness at first, but, you know, when that was going down. But, you know, David seems to handle everything like a champ.
Yeah.
No, yeah, I mean, certainly not. No problems. I mean, yeah, David's a really well-balanced individual. And, you know, just like anybody else, whatever our role is, we take it and we do the most with it that we can. And I'm sure he probably was even hip to the storyline before I was. You know, and he's done a lot with that character.
I
would say probably more than I've done with Raiden. I don't know. But, you know, it's apples and oranges. Depends on stats. It's like comparing baseball players. Someone might say, well, he's my favorite. Well, he's my favorite. Well, he's done more of this. Well, he's done more of that. Whatever. It doesn't matter. They're both on the same team, and there was a champion team, and they won.
Right.
But in the Metal Gear Solid 2, David and I worked a lot together, sitting alongside one another, following waveforms across the screen,
right.
Dialogue. Back then, you know, we weren't chasing pictures.
Right, dubbing, right? Dubbing over the Japanese stuff.
We weren't, well, we were watching just waveforms for time.
Right.
Oh, you know? For the time.
Yeah, that was, I think Paul was telling us about that
his
interview.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it was so bizarre, man, and we had to work to time, but no, there were no images. It was just like, okay. Yeah. So we're watching this, you know, across the screen, and we had to make sure all the acting and everything timed out. That's what I remember about that, and that was just kind of strange and surreal, but... Again, it's what we do. So David and I sat there next to each other and did what we did.
Sure.
And we had our dialogue, and we had our dialogue, and we took our direction, and it was cool.
Nice.
I mean, I'll tell you something David probably didn't tell you, because he and I knew each other before that through mutual acting friends in the community, including Jennifer Hale. And I do remember a time hanging out, the three of us, with some other actors and actresses at a party. I think it was at her apartment. I remember being outside one night, and it was quite fun. And then the next time I saw David was when I was guesting on there was a Spider-Man series, and I'm going to get the name wrong. I'm going to call it The Ultimate Wars, but I'm sure it was called something else. The Marvel fans out there, you can write the answer in, and these gentlemen will probably tell me. But the Fantastic Four appeared in this episode. Okay, and I got to reprise my role as Johnny Storm, the Human Torch. Flame on!
Right.
And David was playing Captain America. So that was the first time David and I worked together, and that predates Metal Gear.
Right.
Yeah.
Wow.
Wow. So, yeah, I was about to ask, like, when was the first time you met David? So I guess that was your first project together, Captain America and the Human Torch.
Yeah, guesting in like this Ultimate Wars with all the Marvel heroes,
right.
And that's the first time we got to work together. And but yeah, we had
like
met.
Said Secret Wars.
Secret Wars.
Secret Wars. There you go. See, I told you I'd get it wrong. I just knew it had wars in there, but Secret Wars. That's what it was. And also, that was something that I remember reading in the comics. As a kid. I was like, oh yeah, they're doing Secret Wars. And I at the time I was like. I wish it was Spider-Man. Of course, I got to be him eventually.
Right.
But, you know, what I remember is, yeah, David and I met as actors, and this is before he went on to work for his friend, whose name escapes me, for the first X-Men movie, that he eventually, you know, he worked as like an personal assistant, and then he came up with some ideas, and then he started writing them out when asked to.
Yep.
Was it Bryan Singer, perhaps, who asked him to
Bryan
do
Singer.
It?
Yeah.
Memory serves correct, and he said that, like, David gave him some input, and the next day he said, "So where are your, you know, where's the stuff?" And David was like, "What are you talking about?" And he said, "You know, what you were telling us about. Where is it? Did you write it?" And he's like, "No." So no, I want you to write it. And David went, "Oh, so that's where it began for David." And then he started writing, and as we all know, he was the man. X-Men.
Yeah.
Yeah.
David. And so then, you know, what changed for David was that he became a writer. He became, you know, more than an actor, a writer, a producer. And then this past year, his film Wolf came out, which was the first film he's directed, a live-action film. And Jennifer Hale actually has a small role in it. If I'm not mistaken, they're both Canadian.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Because I remember when the movie was coming up, and I said, "Hey, pal, I'd love to be in that movie." He's like, "Sorry, man." He goes, "It's we're shooting it in Canada, and you got to be a Canadian citizen." Like, all right, man, that's cool. I go, well, eventually, when you do something here, it'd be awesome. And so I went to the screening of Wolf, which was fantastic. And another Canadian actor here, Philip Hayes, is in it. So I sat next to Phil. And afterwards, David and I went out, hung out with a couple of guys. One was a local guy from L.A., one was visiting from Baltimore, and we just had some food and drinks and had a grand old time. So, so it's amazing how these things work.
It does. You know, that actually kind of explains the new thing that they're working on, The Long Dark, that's set in Canada. So, you know, and they've got Mark Meer doing that as well. So that That explains that project. I was curious on how they probably ended up working together, but I guess Canadians, eh?
Oh, yeah, the Canadian connection, eh? That's weird. So, like, when they come to America, they stop talking like that. So you can't tell that they're from Canada, man. They seem like regular Americans. Then they, like, get duplicitous and, like, they got dual citizenship and they can steal our jobs and go back there and do theirs and then they screw us up the arse. Now, arse, of course, is an English way of saying ass. That's
right.
They'd say ass, but they wouldn't say ass. They'd say the butt.
The butt.
Your next question.
In England, we'd say the butt. They'd say the bum.
Sorry.
All right, so...
keep your bum to the wall. Unless you're a bum on the streets of America, then give them some change, if you have it.
All right, wise words.
All right, my next question to you is, what are some tips you would give to aspiring voice actors? Like myself, I want to be a voice actor, so what would you... give what tips would you give him in terms of getting into the industry and then in terms of acting?
Stay away from his roles.
Stay away. Yeah.
Roles, motherfucker. Yeah. What you want to do is you want to hire me and you pay me. I'm happy to tell you what you need to do. Yeah, that's it. No. I'll answer the question to the best of my ability. I've been asked this on the road. I do conventions often throughout the year. And I've probably done the last 9 years on the road, maybe 10. I can only offer my experience, strength, and hope based on what I've done. And that is, it's acting. So I encourage people to take acting courses. I think improv is probably some of the best, you know, because you get an opportunity to express yourself and through improvisational games. You get to get out of the head, you know, and into action, as opposed to traditional acting, which, you know, I've done plenty of that as well. But what I like about improv is it brings us as adults back to the playground, which is something that got taken away from us, in about junior high, no more recess, right?
Yeah.
So, as an actor, you need to be able to play. You need to be able to be free so that when a director gives you a note or makes a suggestion to try something different, you don't freeze up. Yeah. You're like, okay, got it. I can roll with that.
Sure.
So improv is a great idea. Naturally, voice acting classes, which depending on where you live, there may be some that you can take there in person, hopefully, because I think the best is interacting, you know, as you can with a group. I actually went to a social media seminar last night that was taught by a gentleman who's a voice actor named Jay Preston. And because I wanted to know more about how I can communicate, collaborate, and connect with people in today's society, which is largely internet-based.
Yeah.
But the interesting thing he did say is it is part of the answer to being to social media is being social. And he did talk about skills, about how do you get along with people, how do you ask questions, how many of you are comfortable talking to other people. And so it is true that regardless of the perceived separation due to technology, there is a coming together that still needs the human touch.
Sure.
So be a person, play, do act as much as you can. If somebody has a project and they'd like you to be in it or you want to be in it, ask. It never hurts to ask. Like the questions you're asking me, I'm always asking others, you know, well, how can I get better doing this? What's your experience? And then I take what I like and I leave the rest.
Sure.
So what I share with you, whatever speaks to you, use and take the next right indicated step. And if there's not a class in your town or nearby community, but maybe there's someone who's teaching online, go for that. And if it's somebody who is a working actor and it's within your financial means, you know, check it out. That's, you know, that's all I got right there.
No, those are all great tips. That's a very extensive answer, and I think that's very helpful. So, thank you, that's
awesome.
Great.
Yeah. Ronan, your turn.
All my questions got answered, so I'm just, you guys can take it away from here on.
Okay.
Ask anything you want.
Let's see here. Okay, so my next question is, besides the Heroes of the Storm character that you just did, what other projects are you working on, and where can we see your name coming up next? And do you have any projects you can talk about with us?
Yes. So yeah, folks, know Heroes of the Storm. I play a character named Prince Kael'thas, who was in World of Warcraft, and people have been waiting for years for him to come back. And so I'm happy to say that he's out there. and he's kicking ass and taking aim, so dig it. Also, currently I'm working on a couple of projects. I'm working on a wonderful project here in Los Angeles. It's called The Lizard Queen, with a writer and producer named, well, she has two names. Online, you'd see her under the name of Shea Peyote, but I know her as Sugar Tallarino. And it is this incredible combination of rock icons, psychedelic music, and comedy. And in it, I get to play the Lizard Prince. Now, in rock and roll lore, the Lizard King was Jim Morrison. Welcome, welcome, come on in. The show's about to begin.
Yeah. Sounds like your kind of role.
Yeah. So there is a Lizard King in this, who I won't give that away, but I play the Lizard Prince. Her son, Jay, plays the Lizard Queen, who's this rock and roll, siren, who also has many arms, and it's a real trip, and she's got a little kid, but I'm her son, and I get to do Jim Morrison, you know, awesome. Which is awesome, and I've also been able to do, and it's not a spoiler, it's to support this project when it does come out. I hope Felicia won't tan my hide for this, but I do get to do John, Paul, George, and Ringo for some characters who may be in a group you might have heard of called the Beatles.
Maybe.
Then there's a guy from Motley Crue, and there's a guy from Aerosmith. One's a lead singer, one's a drummer. You figure out who they are, Boom. And I'm voicing them as well. So it's a labor of love, also with Robbie Rist, who's a very famous actor and multi-instrumentalist. He's been in Naruto, you might know. He's also currently in a Disney series, Doc McStuffins. He was the iconic child star of the 70s, Cousin Oliver in the Brady Bunch. He was one of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle voices, and he's one of my best friends. So between the three of us, we're putting together this kick-ass project. In addition to that,
seriously,
and Shay's doing all the music, and Robbie's doing the recording, I believe, and production of that. It's brilliant.
Sounds awesome.
So that's on the way. Also, I'm narrating a series called "I'd Kill for You" for the Investigation Discovery Channel.
Yes,
and it's currently in season two, and you can hear me narrating these noir-type stories that are reenactments of real-life murder mystery love triangles gone awry. And the reenactments are incredible. The interviews with real investigators, friends, co-workers, sometimes family members, brings it all together. And, man, I tell you, by the time it ends, it leaves you wanting more. Oddly enough, have you seen it?
I have a DVR.
They should do one on Jack the Ripper.
You're right. I'm looking forward to that. I really want it to happen.
Yeah.
But this is contemporary stuff. And here's the odd thing. The biggest, the demographic and our biggest fan base is women. So guys, watch your ass.
They learn. They learn things.
They know things that we don't know. And when I'm reading the script and I'm watching these stories,
but we can't really tell them that.
Well, it scares the hell out of me. This is the truth. They send me the Hours episode, and I watch it, and I read the copy, and afterwards, I have to have a palate cleanser, because I swear to you, it scares the hell out of me.
Oh, man.
And there have been times when, like, the next day or later in the day, if I watch it in the morning, I'm walking around the city looking at regular people in line, like, at the shop going,
like paranoia.
Yeah. Paranoia will destroy ya. And so I make sure I watch something light, and then when I go in to record it, though, it's completely different. I'm reading a script. I have the director in my headphones from New York. I usually do it from 7 to 10 a.m. in Burbank in Los Angeles while they're 3 hours later in New York, and I'm getting their direction. And I'm, again, like with voice acting, I am delivering the goods and trying to nail the temperature of the lines without watching it, just having it in my head. And getting their direction about what they hear and what they want to support the image. Mm-hmm. And it's a fine balance, because I know it can't be pushed too hard, because we're letting the video and the music do their work as well.
Right.
You know what I mean? And different directors I've worked with, some get it and they move quickly. Some don't and they push too much. And the end result usually gets fine-tuned. But there are times when I watch it, nobody else would know this, and I'll be watching it and a line will happen and I'll go, that was that fucking director's line reading. God, I hated that.
Yeah, Paul expressed his distaste for line readings.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for answering that. So, yeah, you've got some nice work coming out. Everybody be sure to check it out. If you don't have Heroes of the Storm, I believe it is open to download now on battle.net. If not, you can grab a code for like 10 cents on our sponsors, G2A, over here at Hitbox. You can grab a code to play as... I always pronounce it wrong. I'll let Quentin pronounce it. How do you pronounce it? Prince?
Prince Kael'thas. That's right. Prince Kael'thas would love for you to play with him.
He would. But don't pronounce his name wrong or he'll flay you. Okay?
I'll say it again. Three times. Remember this. Kael'thas. Kael'thas. Kael'thas.
Kael'thas. There we go. Thank we got it. Young has some community questions to wrap up the interview. So, Young, take it away with your amazing community's questions.
Please, community. They've been waiting, and I've been waiting.
I only got a couple because actually a lot of the questions they had were answered already. So I only have like three.
We'll add this. And, Ronan, if you want to check the chat while Young goes through these questions, if we have any chat questions, we'll take some chat questions.
Sure. Because
we love you guys.
Sure.
I want the chatters. I want these chatters. Come on, you chatty.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So my first question, my first community question is from Neptur Kionel from YouTube. What are your thoughts on the phrase, we've managed to avoid drowning, and did you think it's strange while recording the line? Do you remember that line, first of all?
Of course I do, yeah.
Do you, what do you think of it?
Right now, you laugh. You know, we've managed to avoid drowning. Colonel, we've managed to avoid drowning. You know, whatever. You know, it's so out of context for me. But, well, we did, and I guess he was excited about that. And who wouldn't be? And apparently, this fan is as well. I can't even pronounce your name. I know it's not Kael'thas, but it's more difficult.
Right.
So, you know, I dig it. That's all I've got.
That's good. I'm happy.
Otherwise, the series wouldn't have continued and we wouldn't be having this conversation.
That's true. If you would have drowned, that would have been a very bad thing. Did you expect the line to be so well remembered by fans at the time?
No. Not a clue. I really didn't. It just was, you know, another line, another line.
Right. Sure.
It's kind of like got it memorized for Axel. It's like every time I see people, they're like, can you say it?
Yeah, I gotcha.
And I know what they want. I go, what do you, what? You know,
make them say it first.
Yeah. And I think the best part about that line is that is what Paul Eiding followed up with, which was a good job, right? And he gave him this like, here's a cookie, like that kind of thing, and it was just hilarious. Just the combination.
Is that his response?
Yeah. That, it's a good job, right? And I'm like, what? And before that, he says, Raiden, what's your status? And then you say, Colonel, we've managed to avoid drowning. And he's like, good job, Raiden. And I'm like, okay, that's
where the game starts to get wonky with the AI, I believe, you know, right about that time.
It's kind of silly if you think about it. Yeah. It's kind of funny.
We love it, though. You know? No, fans love it. Yeah.
No, I'm glad they do. I love that they love it.
Yeah, no, they absolutely love it. My next question is from Min Torment from YouTube. If you could voice any existing character, that you haven't voiced already, what would it be?
Min Torment.
Well, that's an honor right there.
Yeah. Let's see. What would it be? I think it might be a character that hasn't been created yet that I get to make my own. Because I've Boyhood Dreams Realized, I've got to voice Spider-Man, Speed Racer, Johnny Quest, who I all love. I'd like to do Spider-Man again, and I think they'd be smart to hire me again.
We'll make sure they see this interview, and they will.
I hope they do. They'll be like, this guy's really cocky. I'm like, no. There's a fine line between cocky and confident. I'm confident, and I know I can deliver the goods. That's it. End of story. Let's work together.
Go. That's
good.
There you go. But as far as any other character, there's nothing that comes to mind. I'll have to see something come out. But again, I prefer that it be something that I get involved with, that is unknowingly successful, like the Metal Gear franchise, Kingdom Hearts, or Final Fantasy, we haven't talked about, where I got to play Reno.
Right. That's a big right.
Yeah, so I'd love to do Reno again. I'd actually like to see them do a Final Fantasy series. I think they'd be smart to do that. Mm-hmm. Sure. And also Marcus Damon, who I played in Digimon Data Squad, another redhead.
Right.
I think there is a series that may be bringing him around. So to anybody out there who's working on that series, please bring me back as Marcus. I'd like to be of service.
But in terms of character you haven't voiced yet, you said you've pretty much voiced all the roles you would love to voice, like Spider-Man, so you don't really have anything in mind.
I don't. I mean, you know.
Snake, you want to be Snake now? You can replace Kiefer Sutherland.
Yeah. And then he can play Raiden, and then David can...
play Otacon.
The whole David plays Jack Bauer in 24. We got this whole cycle going. And then you play Jack Bauer.
I would like to voice Jack Bauer.
Oh yeah.
I would like to replace Kiefer Sutherland as Jack Bauer.
I could see that.
You heard maybe it first right here on the codec, man. I'm telling you what.
Yeah. Maybe I'll be his brother. Maybe I'll be his brother. Jim. Like Jack gets killed off, and they need his brother Jim.
Quentin Bauer.
Yeah, Quentin Bauer.
His rock and roll brother. You know.
That's it. His rock and roll brother with an attitude. You know, he likes to really have some fun, kick some ass, rock some tunes, get into it, you know.
Save the world.
Awesome. Fox is watching this.
Of course, save the world with a lot of, you know, lightning coffee.
All right, we got to pitch this. It's too good. Next up, we got Danny from Twitter. What character that you've voiced do you think best represents who you are and what you want to be?
Good question.
Yeah, that's a deep one. Yeah.
It is. I'd have to say Spider-Man, just because of the one line with, if I'm not mistaken, you guys can correct me if I misquote, with great power comes great responsibility.
Yeah,
yep, that's it.
There you go.
Yeah.
Awesome, cool. That's pretty much it for my community questions. If you guys have any, fire away.
There was a few questions that came up from the chat. A lot of them you had already answered, but there was one asking about Kolyat's Krios and Thane Krios in Mass Effect.
Yes.
So I guess I can probably add on to that question, you know. So what was it like going into that role as opposed to, let's say, you know, Raiden from Metal Gear Solid or Lee from Kingdom Hearts or, you know, any of the other roles that you've done? I know those are kind of somewhat smaller roles per se, but, you know, how did you go about performing in those roles?
You made actually an excellent point in your question, because I was going to say, well, pretty much the same way I do any other role, but because... there were fewer lines of dialogue.
Right.
I had to nail this character. I didn't have time to really expand and develop this character like I did Raiden. You know, so I had to really nail it. Mm-hmm. And so I was brought back, you know, to reprise the role.
Yeah.
And so they were kind enough, and they do this as a courtesy for themselves as well as us, the actors, to play a voice sample of what we did previously, so that I could then get back into the role of Kolyat Krios. And the director was wonderful. And there's a whole Canadian thread going on here, guys.
Yeah,
she was from Canada. So I had her in my headphones when I was in the studio on the other side of the glass of the recording engineer with me.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the recording engineer at the time might have been Dave Walsh, if I'm not mistaken. So, hey, Dave, thanks. And it was a really, really quick session, and I love the character. And, of course, you know, Thane passing away as Kolyat's father was something I could relate to, because my father passed away years ago. God rest his soul, Lawrence J. Flynn. And, you know, that's where, when it comes to acting, we are able to draw upon past experiences and bring them into the moment. And that's what I was able to do there. So I didn't have to make anything up. I had something to draw upon.
Right.
Now, interestingly enough, they also gave me a couple additional characters. The sad part is I go on to do my life and another job and other things. And even though these characters may have names, with these video games, they neglect to credit those of us actors who do these additional voices.
Yeah.
So I know I did from the last session for the last game that I was in, I did two additional voices, and the characters were fun, but I don't remember the names.
Wow.
Well, we'll look it up. We'll find it eventually.
Yeah, we'll find that.
I saw when I played the game, as soon as I heard Kolya, I knew that that was you. I knew it.
Yeah.
And
it's funny that the character has a kind of a Raiden vibe to him, where he's kind of a bit of a newbie, you know, like MGS2 Raiden. He's a bit of a newbie assassin kind of guy, and he's kind of young and kind of inexperienced. So I definitely got a bit of that Raiden vibe from the character, which was really cool.
The thing with that game, though, is they add a lot of like synthesis to the
voice. Filtering. Yeah,
so right. You know, I'm sure maybe I've heard your other characters, but it might have been distorted and I might not have caught it as quickly as Kolya.
Right, I mean, Kolya kind of sounds like this.
Yeah.
He had this cup ready just for this impression. He's been saving it.
Yeah, it came to me. I was like, you know.
Prepared, man.
Yeah, that's kind of what it sounded like. You know, he's like, but my father passed away. There was nothing I could do. And that's
very similar to that.
Right? No, it had that. Because I listened to it back, too. It's a little more digitized, of course, but I gave the performance I'm giving you, and then they went in and they digitized it and enhanced it. And the reason I did the cup, because obviously that's a fun way to play and create it, but I was asked recently to do the voice, and I said, I can't.
I don't want to synthesize
it. Yeah, even that doesn't sound right.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, no, I agree with you, and I don't know what's happening with the future of Mass Effect, but God, I would love them to give Kolya a bigger role and bring him back.
I'll tell you what, Mark Meer doesn't have anything to say about it.
Yeah, he doesn't have anything to say.
We asked him if he was going to be back for Mass Effect 4 or if he was going to play any of the characters, and he couldn't comment on it, which means he's probably doing it. So,
yeah, probably.
That's normally how that rolls. Ronan, did we have anything else?
I got another question here. This comes from Fieldsy in the chat. Fieldsy11 says that you voiced a guard in Metal Gear Portable Ops.
Yeah, he said, you know, B,
yeah,
to be exact.
So he wants to know, you know, what was it? You know, was it weird for you to voice, a much smaller character as opposed to riding a Metal Gear? Like, kind of goes back into the Kolya thing with Mass Effect.
Yeah. It is always odd to. Well, yeah. It's more difficult to voice a smaller character because they're tiny, so you got to fit your big voice into their little body. It's very strange, you know. It's weird. It's very Aussie, you know what I mean? Sharon!
He's a small character, so you gotta make it sound like this.
Exactly. No, I was happy to get the work, and I went in, I got in, I got out, nobody got hurt, and we managed to avoid drowning.
That's good. That's always good.
Yeah.
My favorite line.
Oh, man. All right, I guess there's a lot of people in the chat that are asking about you possibly prank calling either David or Paul during this interview. Now, it's totally up to you if you want to do that, of course. Just people are asking for that in the chat from what I'm seeing so far.
There's a famous clip on YouTube of you prank calling David at a convention, and it's infinitely famous on the YouTube community. People love that. It's hilarious.
Like Sean Connery or something, and yeah, some other stuff. Yeah,
I left him a voice message as Sean Connery.
Yeah, it was hilarious.
So. Yeah, that was it. I was at a convention. I was doing a stand-up act, a Q&A, late night. It was an 18-plus panel, and somebody asked me a question about David, and I just thought in the moment, you know what? I go, I'll give him a call, because wherever I was, it was 3 hours earlier in Los Angeles. And I said, I'll give him a call. If he's home, I'll see if he's there, and we'll just ask him some questions. And so I called, and, you know, he didn't pick up. And obviously, I did a Sean Connery impression, you know, like, David, this is Sean Connery. Call me. I'm here. You've got fans in Wichita, Kansas, who would love to hear from you. And then, much to my surprise, thank God I had my phone on, it rang, and it was him. And so I picked up the phone, and before I put him on the mic, I asked him, you know, hey, how are you, buddy? He's like, yeah, I just got out of a movie. What's going on? And I go, well, at this convention, would you mind saying hi? He's like, not at all. So that was it. Now, the funny thing is that the both of you gentlemen have used the same word, prank. It wasn't a prank. I was actually just reaching out to him to, you know, have some fun and like, be of service to the fans. But it's turned into this thing.
Yeah, right now. Yeah.
Flint pranked David Ader. Like, check it out.
It's punked. Quintin edition.
I punked him, yeah. And it's like, but somebody videotaped it. Now, I don't remember that evening being videotaped, and I thought I told people they couldn't videotape it because it's 18 plus, but obviously people, you know, somebody didn't get shit, and I'm happy for it because they got to see that moment, and like you said, it matters to a lot of people, and they got a lot of joy out of it, and I'm glad it's circulating, and I'm glad these people are asking about it, but I won't call David right now, or Paul, just because we're running long on time, and you know, let's leave it to the way it is right now. There's that really cool clip you can see. But when I do speak to David and Paul, I will tell the fans that you asked about me calling.
Sounds good.
Maybe I'll do it in the dark of the night and really fuck with
Maybe next time. Next time we bring you on the show. Because you're coming
I will come back, and I will call them. We have to do it earlier in the show.
Hey, that's fine. There it is. All the way. All
right. So does that wrap up all the questions we have then?
Yep. Most of them are just the same ones that we've already talked about and answered. Okay. So we're good.
Well, Quentin, we talked to you pre-show before we brought you on and let you know there was a couple lines that we wanted to have you say for us if you didn't mind. So I think you should be able to see the yong that you put them in. I can't bring up the chat or it's going to show everybody's names.
Yeah.
So if you guys can take care of it.
Are we off?
No, we're live. We're live right now.
We're still live. I love you people out there. Seriously, you're amazing. Oh, what are you doing? I'm watching you.
Yeah, we're live for I think just about 500 something people.
Oh yeah.
I love it.
I believe is the last time I checked, but yeah, so we've got a couple lines we'd like you to say for us. It should be in your Skype chat.
So, yeah, there's two of them are from Metal Gear Solid 2, the first two, and then the last four are from, or the last three are from MGS4, and then, Ronan, you had one from Axel, I don't know if, But, the one that says, you too mortal, no, I just don't fear death, I don't know if you want me to feed you the line, or if you just want to say it, because Vamp says, you too, you know, whatever, and then you say, no, I just don't fear death, I don't know if, do you just want
to... Yeah. We didn't even talk about me and Phil, but I'll do that real briefly, even though you didn't ask, because you did ask in Phil's interview. But he and I, and he said it in his interview, it's true. He's a funny guy. He goes, Quentin's a funny guy. We're both funny guys. We both have improv and sketch comedy backgrounds. And when we get together, we love to cut up, and we both love doing impressions. So even though he didn't tell you this, because the truth is we had some very serious dialogue to do as Vamp and Raiden in between... during that session, and also when he was Kevin to my Raiden, we did cut up in between when we had the time. We did do some impressions, and we did joke around. We did have some normal conversations like we're having now. And I love Phil, and he's a great actor. And
we love the exchange between you guys. That was, I'd say this, the last couple interviews we've been on, that was probably some of the most intense like feuding in Metal Gear as a saga. You know, that we've seen, and we love that.
Yeah, and yeah, for good reason, because I can't stand the prick. That's a joke.
Yeah, well, we knew we were talking about Vamp and not Phil.
Exactly. Vamp is, no, I can't stand him. He's a bloodsucker.
He is a prick.
Okay? No, he is a
prick. Yeah.
So, that was it. I just wanted to bring that up, because I love being with Phil, and so cool that he got to be Vamp and then Kevin, because again, great energy. He's always so much fun to work with, so easy, and he gets it all, you know. He's so cool. So anyway, let's go to this these dialogue pieces here. So the first one, I've got Daily, Ronan, and Young here with Manchu Avoid Drowning. Now, Young, I'm going to rely upon you to make sure that I'm in the proper voice register for Metal Gear Solid 2 Raiden, and if I'm not, you can redirect me.
Okay.
Okay?
Right. Don't miss this is your big shot, y'all. This is your big shot.
So you know. It's been a while.
That's it. You nailed it. Nailed it. Yeah.
Is that all right?
Yeah.
Let me give you a take two. Take two.
Okay.
Colonel, I've got Daly, Ronan, and Young here. Weave.
managed to avoid drowning.
That's so better.
That's the one they that's the one they wouldn't use.
Damn it.
Well, actually, we'll put that in the scrapbook.
Let me give you, here's a third take. Colonel, I've got Daly, Ronan, and Young here. We've managed to avoid drowning. Avoid drowning. Avoid? There you go.
We've managed to do something.
That's awesome. Take.
And then the second line is, did you say nerd? I don't know if you remember that. It was towards the beginning of the game, and he the colonel says something about a node. And then out of nowhere, Raiden goes, did you say nerd? And he's like, no, Raiden, I said node. So I don't know. That was a weird scene, but I like the line. So, yeah.
Great. I'll give you three in a row. You can pick your favorite.
Awesome.
Did you say nerd? Did you say nerd? Did you say nerd? I said node. Well, then you should have.
Well, that was a good Campbell.
Because I can't understand you, huh?
That was a good Campbell.
You did a good. You did a good Paul Iding.
That was a great Campbell impression.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Wow, that's really good.
Yeah, that is excellent.
So maybe that's the next one I want to play.
Yeah, there we go.
I want to thank Paul, by the way, Paul Iding and Phil Lamar, because you worked with interviewing both of them, and they both reached out to me. Phil, I didn't get his message till after the fact. Paul, I got, and he's the one who made the connect for us. So that's I want to thank those guys.
I tweeted at him today and thanked him for that. I mean, the whole cast has just been amazing so far.
Yeah,
yeah, so Christopher Randolph, you've interviewed as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was great.
So next line is, I am lightning, the rain transformed from MGS4.
Done. I am lightning, the rain transformed.
Awesome. Next up is
I am lightning, the rain transformed. I am lightning, the rain transformed.
Nice.
Awesome, thank you.
Awesome.
That last one, yeah.
It's good.
With the hand.
yes.
Next up is the No, I Just Don't Fear Death line. Do you want me to feed you the line? Because there's a line before that, you two immortal, that Phil Lamar says.
Yeah, give me the vamp.
You too, immortal.
I just don't fear death. I just don't fear death. I just don't fear death.
Awesome.
Nice.
Next up is Snake, it's my turn to protect you from MGS4.
Snake, it's my turn to protect you. Snake, it's my turn to protect you. Snake, it's my turn to protect you.
Awesome.
And where are we sending your check? Okay.
Yeah.
I will happily give you my address once we shut this down.
Okay.
And Ronan, I guess you had a line that he wanted to that you wanted him to say.
Yeah, this one's is just
yeah.
They show like towards the end of Kingdom Hearts 3, you know, Axel or Lee shows up and they're like, "Axel," and he goes, "Axel, the name's Lee. Got it memorized." So yeah.
Well done. I don't have to do it. Thanks. No, okay. No worries. No, I remember this. In fact, I just saw it the other day, and he was like, "The name's Lee. Got it memorized." So it's a younger Axel, because Axel would be got it memorized. But yeah, there you go.
Thank awesome. You so much.
Thank you very much. That was epic.
We really, really appreciate you stopping by today. Did you have anything else that you wanted to say to the fans? Any plugs? I know you've got the Quentin Flynn TV, or is it inlikeflynn.tv? Would you tell us a little bit about that now that we've got all of the viewers that we're going to have?
Coming soon will be inlikeflynn.tv, and it will have everything I do, including some on-camera comedy stuff, on-camera music, and blogging. So be looking out for that. That's a new adventure. I may also include some voice demo stuff as well, but it'll be an all-encompassing website about all things Quentin Flynn. I'd love you to follow me on Twitter, and that's at Quentin Flynn.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty simple. Quintonflynn. What else? If you're in Los Angeles, you can come see me play at the clubs out here. I'm with a cover band, an 80s tribute band called Total Recall.
Wow.
That's right, Total Recall. Oh, my God.
That's a lot of fun. Also, if you're a Los Angeles native, on Friday nights, we do something called KTEL 70s Night with my friend Robbie Rist, and we do tunes from the decade of the 70s between 7 and 10 at Red Ball's Rock and Roll Pizza in Moore Park, California. What else have I got? I've got some conventions coming up. I will probably post those on my Facebook page. I will tweet them. And I just want to thank all of the fans out there for your support, your continued support, your interest. I want to thank you, Ronan. I want to thank you, Young. I want to thank you, Swift Strike. Clayton, you're my favorite.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I want to thank you all for having this dialogue and this opportunity to answer some questions, to have some fun, and to play, because that's what it's all about, you know? It's all about the love, so let's keep it up. Let's keep it alive.
Awesome. I feel the same way. So thanks again so much. We will see you guys next time on the next episode of The Codec. We're not leaving just yet, but we're going to take the audio and video down real quick so we can talk to Mr. Flynn for just a second, and then myself, Yong, and Ronan will be right back. So stay tuned, guys, and we'll be right back. I just said that. Look at me. I'm an amazing host.
You are amazing.